most believe that changing someone's gender is immoral and that gender, transgender people are ill. To talk quickly about the legal challenges facing the LGBT community in Lebanon, while there's no specific law targeting LGBT individuals, there's Article 534 of the Lebanese Penal Code, which states that any sexual intercourse contrary to the order of nature is punishable by up to 1 year in prison. Of course, that article is open to different interpretations, but it has been historically used to target LGBT individuals, more specifically gay men and trans women. In addition, trans individuals are also arrested for alleged sex work, illicit drug use, and violating moral codes of conduct, whatever that might mean. More recently, however, there have been some remarkable court rulings that are or can be considered pro-LGBT. There was a ruling that stated that homosexuality cannot be considered contrary to the order of nature, and therefore the law does not apply and cannot be used to target homosexual people. And the other, there was another court ruling that states, that's affirmed the health and legal rights of a trans man. And we'll be talking a bit more about these in details in subsequent presentations today. In addition to the legal challenges, we have the healthcare challenges that face LGBT individuals. Of course, there's limited research out there, but what we know is that there is significant discrimination in healthcare settings, including denial of service, fear of accessing healthcare services because of fear of breach of confidentiality or being outed, lack of safety, and discrimination, which are both are considered barriers to accessing healthcare services. And while we don't have specific data yet, we know that conversion therapy has become more common and is actually being talked about more and more. And in Lebanon, they still refer to it as conversion therapy. The Lebanese law also considers transgender identity to be a mental health condition, and this is somewhat controversial because, well, it is considered a mental health condition. That diagnosis actually conveys certain protections from the law, from the Article 534, and we'll be talking a bit more about that shortly as well. Now, to talk more about the kind of background which LEBMASH was founded. We noticed as a group of healthcare professionals that the LGBT population in Lebanon is facing multiple challenges, as I talked about. And so we decided in 2012 to form the Lebanese Medical Association for Sexual Health with a mission of advancing healthcare for LGBT individuals and sexual and reproductive health for all individuals in Lebanon. We focus on healthcare advocacy through training, education, and research. And because most of us live in different cities, we founded LEBMASH virtually in 2012. There were six of us at first, and actually the foundation of LEBMASH was solidified when several board members attended a GLAMA meeting and actually FaceTimed me from there. We've since then looked up to GLAMA for actually inspiration and support. Currently, we have 9 board members. They are in different countries still. So we have some in the U.S., in Europe, and in Lebanon. But we have a much more multidisciplinary team. We also have an executive director, 3 full-time staff members, many, many partners and allies in the community in Lebanon and in the United States, and many volunteers that help us with our work. We have focused on significant research activities over the past few years. I'll just mention one that's really close to my heart, which is the third one here, LEBGUI, which was a research project aimed at creating a database of LGBT affirmative healthcare providers to improve access to healthcare of LGBT individuals. We went live about 2 weeks ago. Another kind of yearly activity that we have is the Breaks the Silence Award, which is an a scholarship that is meant to enhance interest in research on LGBT health. We have the winner, actually, of the LGBT award, of the Break the Silence award with us today. The award actually is a grant of $1,500 that goes towards attending a Guanma conference every year. We also work to promote LGBT health education, and we've had several activities over the past few years. These have included translating LGBT health guidelines to Arabic, included organizing public media campaigns around LGBT topics. We had an educational video about coming out and the challenges of being faced with conversion therapy upon coming out, as well as workshops and curricula to educate healthcare providers and healthcare provider students on LGBT health. With regards to healthcare advocacy, we've worked closely with the Lebanese Psychiatric Association and Lebanese Psychological Society in order to release very strongly worded statements reaffirming that homosexuality is not an illness and therefore does not need treatment, and to condemn conversion therapy. In our work, we have multiple barriers to overcome. These include cyberbullying, cyber attacks that have actually crashed our website a couple of times. We have had some hostile religious, both Christian and Muslim, backlash in support of conversion therapy. So we're dealing with a relatively conservative social landscape, an unstable political situation, and laws in Lebanon that are hostile to the LGBT individual, or that are often interpreted to be hostile to the LGBT individuals. And finally, we have the geographical barriers to try to overcome, because we all live in different time zones, and so logistically having meetings over supervising our project managers or our team in Lebanon on the ground becomes somewhat more challenging, because we're not there in person, or most of us are not there in person. And that kind of brings me to the end of my presentation. I am going to invite my colleague to join us, Dr. Omar Fatal, who will be talking about the LGBT health. Omar Hakush.
So many Omars, some false confusions. All right, thanks, Hussam, for that wonderful presentation. Hussam says, for the background around LebMash broadly, and now I'm going to talk about a specific project that we did throughout last year, and it was the LGBT Health Week, with the first LGBT health conference to be held in Lebanon. So let's start off a little bit about a background around the LGBT Health Week. Of course, Hussam talked a lot about the background about LebMash generally, but we have been conducting a lot of workshops on LGBT health with students here and there, but we were really reflecting more on Glamma's experience at a conference like this, right? Just like the one we're sitting in here today, we wanted to concentrate all of our efforts into 1 week, make sure that we bring in workshops and also education into a conference, but also sort of have more of health policy and a public awareness campaigns around that same week. So we started by brainstorming about such a week, right? We thought first, what do we want to come up with as a theme? And something that's been recurring in Lebanon, a lot of people are approaching marginalization and discrimination from different points of views, and we wanted to bring up the health point of view. This is what this discrimination that LGBT individuals face, this is how it can affect their health. From a legal perspective, from a social perspective, this is the effect that it has on health. A new approach to what is the negative effect of this discrimination. And we really wanted to integrate both public awareness, in addition to the education of health providers that we do, as well as a health policy aspect to it. How can we change more on the policy level, in addition to reaching out to everybody, to everybody's homes? So a framework, of course, in public health, we love frameworks. So this is one that we based our health week on. We wanted to focus on public awareness and around marginalization. And we thought, how are we gonna be able to do this? Reach out to people through social media, make a small videos, but also have interviews with the media, with the televised media, and I'll get to talk about that in a bit. The second one was educating healthcare providers, doing a conference, but also doing workshops for lengthier and more specific education. And Suha's gonna get to talk about that at the end of this presentation. And the third one was policy lobbying. And we wanted to really talk to healthcare professional organizations here. We wanted to make sure that they have a position against marginalization, and we wanted to make sure that that position is well heard through a press conference. So I'll start off with the public awareness campaigns. The first one was a media campaign. So it's a social media campaign with three videos, and we wanted to adapt something also new. We wanted to have relatives, friends, families of LGBT individuals talk about their own experiences and how they've noticed the marginalization that faces their loved ones. And we really, I mean, we had a lot of feedback in the past that people feel like they can't relate to LGBT individuals. They feel like they're, you know, extraterrestrials or whatever. We wanted to show them that these are the loved ones of these people who are talking. So people can feel like, oh, I can relate to this mother. I can relate to this sister. And we wanted to really bring it closer to people who are not very familiar with our community. We also wanted, and we were able to get a quite nice amount of views, 30,000 views per each video, which is not too bad for a country as small as Lebanon. So originally we wanted to show a video, the link is not working here, but briefly it was a sister talking about how her lesbian sister Sarah, as one of her sisters, how she just loves and she is in love with a person, but she faces discrimination on a daily basis just because of who she loves. And so the video ends with marginalization kills. So people can just really know the effect. You know, when you put it that way, it is really the effect that these microaggressions that people are facing every day, this is what eventually it will lead as an effect on their health. We also had media coverage. We were able to go on the televised media. We were able to go on three different stations in Lebanon and talk about in morning shows and even in nighttime TV to be able to reach to different communities. But also, we were able to talk about this within the media and online as well, both here in the U.S. and in Lebanon. So here's an article from the Los Angeles Blade about the LGBT Sexual Health Week, and then more from our TV presentations. Briefly, what were some lessons learned? And I'm sure anybody who's worked with the media can relate to this. I'm sure some Glamour members would also be able to think about some of these experiences. So one, there was a lot of comfort from LGBT allies in sharing these videos, which we thought was interesting. Particularly, they felt that they relate more to them. Oh, this is a friend of mine. Oh, this is not outward LGBT individuals talking. It's sort of their relatives. So well received by the allies. We really wanted to diversify our outlets. Social media definitely reaching the younger populations. However, TV is still important, particularly in a country like Lebanon, where it reaches, I would say, a different population who is just bombarded by all of this, whatever they're getting on TV. So we wanted to include some of those messages there. And the third is obviously the media has a lot of tricks. They want to ask the same questions. They want to do frequently asked questions. They want to do things about religion, and that's the same question that comes up. I know we've talked a lot about this in the conference, but we always get this question: how can we, in a religiously conservative country, how can we, in a country like Lebanon that has our values, accept LGBT individuals? And what we try to do as an approach is say, these are our scientific, we're here to present scientific evidence, and this is what we're going to talk. Hopefully, that's so far has been the strategy that we've been using. We're going to power through the rest of the slides. So first, health policy. We spoke with allies at the Order of Nurses, Order of Social Workers, and the Ministry of Public Health. And we were able to tell them, all right, you guys need to come out and speak against discrimination that faces LGBT individuals. And we wanted to make sure that we'll take those statements, put them in a press conference, and hold them accountable to those statements. And really, lessons learned there is that there are allies in each space. We never thought we'd be able to find somebody to help us in the Ministry of Public Health. But we dug deeper, we were able to know somebody who actually is against LGBT discrimination. And that's how we were able to climb up the ladder and eventually snowball to a whole project. So never lose hope in finding an ally in any space. And definitely show appreciation for all allies. Recognize the fact that they're doing something outside of their comfort zone, maybe something that their coworkers are not appreciating, and just thank them for what they're doing for the community. So education, as I said, I was going to talk about later, but I wanted to reflect on some of the post-Health Week effects that we saw. So we were able to, through those allyships, through those partnerships, build a whole project with the Ministry of Public Health, which is major news, right? In a country that where sort of a lot of laws are used against LGBT individuals, we were able to leverage the ministry to help us out with the project. Now we're working on a training manual for mental health providers to train them around LGBT mental health. However, there was some backlash, both from the religious conservatives and both from proponents of conversion therapy. After we did this conference, there were different people who come out and speak publicly to say conversion therapy works, conversion therapy is the way to go. So that was something that we saw after we did the Health Week. And then some religious backlash. As Hussam had mentioned, our website was shut down for quite a while after it was hacked by religious conservatives who put up blunt homophobic messages on our website. So visibility comes, of course, with some resistance, but that should not be something that stops the organization from moving forward. So future steps, we're very glad to say that we'll be able to continue working on LGBT Health Week 2018 through our supporters at the Agnes Varis Foundation, who are going to support this new initiative. We're going to work more around training, but we'll obviously continue working on training throughout the year, non-stop efforts to work with different healthcare providers, multidisciplinary approach always, and then fixing curricula in different schools, whether it's medical schools, social work schools, or nursing, and trying to integrate this into the programs. And finally, of course, I feel like, and that's something that we also got from this conference really, is reflecting on how to approach the religious question when it comes to LGBT health. How would we have a new approach? What would we be able to do in order to face this common question that we get? That's it for me. I'm gonna pass the mic to Kate, who's gonna talk more about our research around knowledge on transgender health.
Thank you, Hussam. State of transgender health and healthcare in Lebanon. So I'm going to start out with a few points about current events and policy. Oops, that's not changing. It's changing here.
For me, it was the opposite. It's changing here.
Sorry. Taken of her that were then distributed to the media. So this kind of treatment is not unusual. If arrested, transgender people are at risk of physical and sexual abuse, torture, and ridicule from law enforcement. Here we see a different kind of headline from 2015 about a court ruling in favor of a transgender man, supporting his right to legally change his gender marker, as well as his right to treatment and privacy. So let's take just a minute to look at the diagnosis of gender dysphoria. So we already mentioned that Lebanese law considers a transgender identity to be a mental health condition. Therefore, the diagnosis of gender dysphoria provides protection from arrest for transgender people. It also offers the opportunity to legally change identification papers. So we really see how complex things are in Lebanon. There's this grievous mistreatment that transgender people experience, as well as some progress, a little bit, and some protection. Okay, so to better understand the context of healthcare for transgender people in Lebanon, we targeted three stakeholder groups: NGOs who work with the transgender population, healthcare providers who care for transgender patients, and local pharmacies. Through purposive and snowball sampling, we recruited our stakeholders, ultimately interviewing four NGO representatives and nine healthcare providers, and 10 pharmacies responded to our survey on hormone medication accessibility. So let's have a look at the results. So one of the overwhelming themes throughout our analysis was stigma and discrimination. NGO representatives and healthcare providers agreed that stigma and discrimination are a major problem within society as well as within the healthcare system. So there's this family rejection, loss of job, homelessness, poverty, survival sex work pathway that we saw repeated throughout our interviews. Also from our analysis, it was shown that healthcare providers in Lebanon show stigma and discrimination in a variety of ways. Some providers outright refuse to treat transgender patients, and others treat them poorly or even attack them verbally or physically. And as was mentioned, some providers continue to practice conversion therapy. So in general, healthcare providers in Lebanon don't really know how to communicate with or treat transgender patients. So therefore, this lack of available providers exists. Very few locations actually provide services for basic primary care, much less transgender-specific needs, such as mental health care, hormone therapy, speech therapy, surgical care. For example, only a few psychiatrists in the Beirut area were considered competent with an understanding of gender identity, and only one doctor was referred to for hormone therapy. So this dearth of providers is likely from a combination of a lack of willingness as well as a lack of knowledge. Our analysis also showed a thread of unreliable information as well as poor communication among providers, NGOs, and the transgender population. So the information about transgender-specific services was reported differently by different people. And one of the most stark examples of this was surrounding hormone medication. So some people responded that hormones definitely required a prescription, others responded that hormones definitely did not require a prescription, and others readily admitted that they had no idea. So without general agreement of what is available and what isn't, it becomes difficult to care for transgender people in an appropriate and acceptable way. So of course, it's not surprising to hear that transgender individuals often avoid seeking health care, maybe due to a fear of rejection, humiliation, abuse, or unwilling status disclosure. Okay, so let's take a minute to have a look at what we learned about hormone treatment in Lebanon. So we learned that there are very few providers available to assist transgender people with hormone therapy. So one, according to our analysis, in all of Beirut. We learned that pharmacies readily carry hormone medications, but what is available differs depending on the location. Masculinizing hormones are generally less available than feminizing hormones. We learned that some hormones do require a prescription and some don't, and again, this varies across locations. Masculinizing hormones tend to require prescriptions more often than feminizing hormones, and they also tend to be more expensive. So we already know that paying for healthcare can be difficult for a transgender individual, and the same barrier exists when considering hormones. So many people end up getting their hormones from the black market instead of through the healthcare system, and this can lead to an increased risk of blackmail and other potential negative health outcomes. So this is a real problem in Lebanon. Okay, so let's have a look at what our providers say specifically about care for transgender people in Lebanon. Our providers see around 0 to 3 transgender patients per year, and there are no common resources, guidelines, or standards available for transgender care. Although now LevMash has translated the WPATH guidelines into Arabic, so providers have this as a reliable resource, and will hopefully start using them. Out of those who do seek care, less than half have received mental health care, and up to 80% have at least initiated hormone therapy. Many of these people end up stopping hormone therapy due to a lack of access, so that obviously leads to inconsistent treatment. And there is also just a general lack of follow-up care within this population. So we've obviously seen many obstacles to healthcare for transgender people in Lebanon. And here is just a table, sort of an overview of what we have discussed. The dearth of competent providers, the lack of support within the healthcare system. Another thing that came up through our analysis is that health insurance does not cover transgender-specific health services or mental health care. So this contributes to the barriers. And here are some more sociocultural and financial barriers, most of which we've talked about. Okay, so let's quickly look at provider education in Lebanon. So most providers from our analysis agreed that training in Lebanon regarding transgender health is lacking. And of those providers who do see transgender patients, they're self-educated. So this creates a specific challenge because providers really don't know what to expect, which can obviously reduce the quality of care. NGOs and providers wholeheartedly agree that improving provider education is key to promoting transgender health. And this is a quote from one of our interviews. When someone doesn't know about something, they'll keep fearing it. They'll keep not knowing how to deal with it. So how do we increase and improve education in order to shift away from this fear and this lack of understanding? So NGO representatives and healthcare providers agreed that one necessary step is to include transgender health as part of the curriculum for all health profession students and as continuing ed for all professionals. And we'll get into that a little bit later. There are various ways to incorporate this topic into education. So there's early and repeated education during medical school and residency training that includes not only medical competencies and the specific needs of the transgender population, but also cultural sensitivity. And future steps for LoveMash include training providers, both through online modules and through active workshops. So these are just some of the ideas that can be used. And also using media, which we've also talked about a little bit, to broadcast scientific-based discussions on transgender health. And obviously, local conferences, grand rounds at hospitals, things like that are other ideas. Some other more specific conceptual recommendations that came out of our analysis were just a continual focus on respect of the human being, also emphasizing the role that society plays, especially regarding mental health. Keeping providers involved came up a lot, and asking them what they already know, asking them how transgender people are currently treated within their practice. This can encourage reflection and maybe spark some ideas within themselves. Also, remembering to be thoughtful and considerate. We don't really want to push anybody away. So if we focus on improving healthcare or emphasize comprehensive care, we can bring them into an educational mindset that they're already comfortable with and then move forward from there. And finally, even before education, the first step towards improving the treatment of transgender individuals is to hold healthcare providers accountable and to make them responsible for their actions. And here's another quote from one of our interviews. If I'm a healthcare provider and I get a patient, it's my duty, it's my sworn duty to treat them well, to communicate with them well, and provide accurate treatment with them, and diagnose them well. If I don't want to do this thing, I should refer them to somebody else who will do it. So next steps, both for LoveMash and for Lebanon. It's important to disseminate information on what is currently available to both the transgender population and to health professionals at all levels of training. So this should include where appropriate care is available, as well as these translated WPATH guidelines that I mentioned. And these guidelines are currently available on the WPATH website as well as the LoveMash website, and we've had some positive feedback from providers in Lebanon and the U.S. about their use. So hopefully this will continue. It's also important to create a network between providers and NGOs who work with the transgender population to encourage a more positive experience for both patients and providers. And this can include an easy referral system, culturally sensitive integrated services, things like that. A communication campaign specifically focusing on educating and supporting parents and families of transgender individuals can have very positive effects on society's perceptions, which can encourage a positive shift. And also efforts to alter policies that affect transgender people can be important, such as continuing the work that led to the court ruling in favor of the transgender man that I mentioned earlier, training police officers to treat transgender people with respect and then holding them accountable, things like that. And then finally, conducting research that directly includes the transgender population. And we can use that to direct future advocacy, communication, and health program work in Lebanon. And this is something else that LevMash is currently working on. Thank you.
Okay, so they kept on referring that I'll be talking about the education piece, so here I am. So I'll be talking about what we did to try to create evidence-based workshops that we can provide to students. And because this is not moving, what did you guys do?
We just got out of it.
And so we know that LGBT individuals are at a disproportionate risk for health disparities. We know that they suffer from multi-level barriers to accessing culturally appropriate healthcare. And we know that from looking at all the studies that we do here in the US. But in Lebanon, it takes it to another level, where there aren't many studies done, and there are a lot of religious and very conservative communities that are part of the healthcare system. And individuals who really need the appropriate care do not know where to go and how to access that. But now that our Love Guide is live, I think that would be very helpful. But also, caring for LGBT individuals requires creating an LGBT-affirming environment that attends to their specific needs, their sensitivities, and the challenges that the community goes through. We need to have an understanding. But we have that information knowing that all the providers went to school and did not get the education needed. We do not have, until now, any information to teach nurses, physicians, social workers in Lebanon on LGBT health and how to care for LGBT individuals and what are they at risk for and what needs to be managed. And so LGBT individuals find themselves educating providers about their needs. So why do these healthcare professionals not want to care for LGBT individuals? And mostly it's because they really don't know. So we have reports that the LGBT individuals have been refused care, providers have had poor bedside manners, there have been reports of verbal abuse, there has been insensitive environments, but most of this can also be related to lack of knowledge. And so we have a lot of information about the lack of LGBT health knowledge and training in many of the curricula. And so we wanted to do something about this. So that's why we wanted to create a curriculum to provide basic education about LGBT concepts and terminology, LGBT health issues, sexual history, and gender identity assessment. And we wanted to use it using advanced educational methods. And we use active learning strategies, numerous case studies, and we also invite a panel of LGBT individuals from Lebanon to share with the students their real life scenarios and experiences within the healthcare system, and to try to answer the students' questions and concerns. So a little overview of our curriculum. It was developed as part of the Johns Hopkins School of Public Health internship with LevMash, And we worked on an evidence-based mixed didactic and interactive curriculum that would enable health professionals to teach the Lebanese medical. And it was initially started as a medical students workshop, and then we moved it and became an interprofessional workshop. So the curriculum outline includes basics about LGBT health. We talk about some of the sciences and myths about sexual orientation, and we share with the students what has been going on, because some of them might be younger than walking through the issues that we talked about today. We talk about cultural competency and professionalism, sexual health needs of LGBT individuals in Lebanon. And we use a lot of, after each of the sessions, active learning exercises, including an exercise where students practice to take sexual history. We have an exercise where there's cultural competency exercise where students identify their social identity and come to realize their biases. And there are some clinical scenarios where students discuss care of LGBT individuals. And we have a case study about a trans woman, a case study about a trans man, and we also have case studies about a gay man. We also value most the panel of LGBT individuals, and we always try to thank them because they really get to the inner secrets of what happened to them and within the healthcare system. And students have a roundtable and they ask them questions. And most of the questions, for example, this year from students were, how can we provide better care for you when we graduate and become the providers ourselves? And that was one of the most important questions asked, because we realized that even people moderating, Hassan and I were moderating that session, we work with LGBT individuals here in the US, but we got answers that we would have never thought of on where to sit in a clinic, how to ask the right questions in Arabic. Remember, many of us who practice in the US with LGBT individuals do that in English, and we go to Arabic and we talk with a gendered language. It's very similar to Spanish. And so we had to learn, and it was a good learning experience for students. And these are some pictures with Hassan here and myself up there from the workshop. So how was the attendance? The first year, it was our first year, we had 30 medical students attend the workshop. The second year, we had 50 nursing, medical, and social work and psychology students attend the workshop, and we're growing. We have a lot of demand, and many people are asking us for more sessions. We provide pre and post surveys to see the increased knowledge of students. We have our pre and post survey includes 6 Likert scale questions, 4 short answer questions, and 5 multiple choice questions. The first year we had only 17 pre post completed surveys. The second we had 18 pre post completed surveys, so our response rate is low. And so for next year we have a plan to integrate time during the curriculum so that we would try to increase the response rate. And we want to share with them the results from what we have had from the pre-post survey and explain why is it important for us to learn the outcomes of what we're trying to do throughout the day. So these are some sample questions that we asked. How comfortable are you treating a gay, lesbian, and bisexual patient? How comfortable are you treating transgender patients? We asked them some knowledge questions to see if they learned anything, like what is gender identity? What is the most effective type of protection against STDs? So what's the outcome? The pre-post survey showed that there was a significant increase in student awareness and knowledge at the end of that workshop. They learned about sexual history, gender identity, things that they did not know about. There was an increased student knowledge about healthcare and LGBT health needs. Qualitative reports, students talked to us all the time and they wrote down some of the notes, and there was the strength of that multidisciplinary interaction that we did in the second year during the case studies. And they said that this mirrored what they do in actual practice when they would graduate. There was an open communication with members of the LGBT community and their experiences with the healthcare system and what constitutes an LGBT affirming environment and interaction was shared, and this was a valuable lesson learned. They talked about the difficulties of translation from English to Arabic, because many of these students learn either in English or in French in school, and then they practice in Arabic. And so, and Arabic, again, is a gendered language. So they had some issues, and this is something that we put on our to-do list to kind of look at in the future. So the curriculum has been successful. We have had increased attendance, and there has been requests for more workshops to be done. LGBT individuals panel was a great success, and a good learning experience. The active learning exercises that we use increase the confidence and familiarity with the topics discussed. And the collaboration among the different health disciplines was also a big favorable thing that we did. The evaluations were good, but we had an 8-hour workshop. It is a long day, it is a Sunday in March, so it's not the favorite thing for students to be doing on that day. And so we have been working on trying to shorten the workshop to a 4-hour workshop and maybe conduct 2 workshops instead of 1 workshop. And we also learned that we always need to be prepared for any technological challenges in a country where electricity can just black out at any minute, and we had to come up with some lessons learned. So some reflections. Bringing LGBT health content to students is still in its infant stages, and there is room for continuous growth. The positive feedback and excitement from students, we got excited for that. And so this will help us enhance and evolve our curriculum. And this curriculum can serve as an example for others who aim to administer LGBT health content to a curriculum in areas where LGBT individuals are disproportionately suffer. And nowadays, we've been working and trying to connect with neighboring Arab countries who would want to do something similar and introduce LGBT health into their curriculum. So our future plans are to revise the curriculum, which we are doing now, increase the number of workshops provided throughout the year, and we're talking to other NGOs who could help us with that. Collaborate with other Arab countries, which is something we are trying to do, and Tunisia might be our first country to try to experiment with. Better integrate the pre-post surveys into our day and disseminate this experience and learn from it more. So in conclusion to what we all have been talking about, Lebanon is a liberal country, but yet it's conservative, where LGBT rights and health concerns are disproportionately marginalized. So LGBT individuals are neglected in the social, educational, healthcare, and political domains, thus leading to a major health disparity. The intersectionality between the Lebanese Criminal Code 534, which was used to prosecute same-sex sexual practices with limited social acceptance, decreased access to healthcare, and the discomfort of healthcare providers to promote LGBT health created an environment of contestation with organizations that promoted health equity and LGBT rights. So since 2012, we have been working hard on our pillars, research, creating a national conversation about LGBT health issues, self-advocacy, contributing to health policy and education. LabMash's experience is an exemplar of a journey of marginalization and resilience that led to successful and challenging outcomes like we just talked about today. And we have many lessons learned, and we hope to continue to do our work. Thank you. I would just like to say hi to Sarah, who was supposed to be one of our presenters, and her flight got canceled. So we've been trying to let her to have a dramatic entrance, but he did not.
Sorry if I missed this, but which schools in Lebanon were represented at the day where you're on your full day workshop?
We have, in Lebanon, I'm not sure if you're aware of the educational system, we have the American University of Beirut, and then we have representation from the medical students there and from the nursing students. We also have the French University,
St. Joseph
University, and we have representation from there. We have the Lebanese University representation from students.
Bellarmine
University had medical and nursing students, so we had we also tried to make sure that we have representation from every school and college out there. This year, we're trying to make sure that we survey the schools and make sure we have like maybe 5 or 6 from each school, and then try to help them go and do some transitional and include conversations on campus in the universities. The first year, it was only med students and wanted to see what the experience would be. The second year, we had nursing students from every nursing school. We have nurses on our board who really have good contacts, and we got contact students from every nursing school in the country. So we're trying to make it as inclusive as possible. We have the French educated, the English educated, the Lebanese University, and so we had everyone.
We made an effort to maintain contact information for those who have gone through the course.
Yes. Yeah.
It'd be interesting to see 2 to 3 more years from now.
Yeah, and many of them end up being our volunteers at some point. They really get that experience of they want to do more. And we could, that's a very good idea, Bianca, you can note it down. We could always follow up with them in a couple of years once they start practicing themselves to see what changes did they do to.
Because that's the pinnacle of medical education, mm-hmm. health education, right? That it's influencing patient outcomes. So to
true.
Be able to survey people down the road and say, you know, how are you, what are your interactions with LGBT patients like?
I also think about it as what we're starting to do is kind of like a pilot that's stretching over a few years, and this is going to grow from here. The original sample of students is self-selected,
right.
but our hopes and we aspire to reach in the future to all students.
Right.
And eventually to incorporate this curriculum that we now give as a workshop, to incorporate it into the medical school curriculums.
Like what we didn't talk about today, but we also now have some colleges and schools that are including LGBT case studies in their education and simulation. And I know that the American University of Baylor School of Nursing is trying to do something like that maybe in the spring semester, like that soon. So one of our board members is a faculty at the college, and she's been trying to push that through curriculum. And so we're trying to do that. Not only students get LGBT health education at our workshops, but also we're trying to have them exposed to it within their curriculum.
Yes. Thank you all for this presentation. I really liked that you took the training to an interdisciplinary approach. I think that's really important to get all sorts of providers. I wonder, and I'll preface this by saying I know literally nothing about medical record collection or insurance in Lebanon, but have you thought about expanding the training to non-clinical administrative staff in clinics? Because since those are often the first people that patients interface with in the clinics, and I wonder if you've ever considered it.
That's a very good idea. And that is actually something we talked about. We are not there yet. We are trying to solidify what we have right now, and then this will be like future steps for us.
But definitely we're trying to integrate it. Actually, I talked very briefly about the Ministry of Public, the project around the mental health and training manual for mental health providers at the big term. We are trying to also put it sort of in the hands of the providers who come to this training. You know, if you're a psychiatrist, if you're a psychologist, we're going to tell you, you need to work about the environment as a whole to be welcoming, and that includes your administrative person right at the front desk who is taking the names, because that's the first interaction. We're trying to focus on the environment setting and putting it in the hands of the providers themselves who are receiving this training. Hopefully also some future steps to work with hospitals at large to see if they're ready to say, you know, the administrative people, the people who are on the front line, they need to be more welcoming and to change the environment there. But yeah, definitely an excellent idea to focus on.
So I'm just curious about your board. I wonder how many people are on your board and what disciplines they are.
Yeah, we have 9 individuals, 3 of which are
what?
Six are here from all over the U.S. And then we have 2 individuals in Lebanon. So psychology, we have people from nursing. We have 4 individuals from nursing on the board.
OBGYN.
And so from the medical fields,
why
yeah.
Can you
yeah.
introduce us? Easy.
Yeah, sure. So Soha is a, I'm going to do it.
Okay, so I'm a nursing faculty at UMass Boston, and I have practiced in Lebanon for a little more than 10 years as a clinician, as a nurse, and I did a little more, some administrative work as well. So I have and I grew up in Lebanon, so I have that bridge, and I do work with LGBT health here in the U.S. as well.
So I actually come also from a French background, so balancing out in Lebanon, there's like this lot of tension, I would say, between English-based schools and French-based schools. I was taught medicine in French, so come from that field. I now am in internal medicine residency. I focus a lot on public health in the past. And when I was in Lebanon, I started off working more in activism and LGBT rights, and then transitioned to this wonderful organization. Started working more on public health and health awareness beyond advocacy.
Okay. Yeah.
Hi, I'm a psychiatrist. I'm based out of Chicago. I do mostly telepsychiatry. And I also grew up in Lebanon, went to the American University of Beirut, and practiced it with the World Health Organization for a couple of years, and then did my residency in the States, and practiced in Canada and in the U.S.
And so we have Hassan, who is an OBGYN, and you want to talk about yourself?
I'm an obstetrician and gynecologist, and with a focus on minimally invasive surgery and transgender health.
I'm Omar Fatal, we've met before, I'm a psychiatrist at Bellevue, and I have a previous career also in working in LGBT rights in the past, and then I kind of now shifted to LabMash for the last few years, and focusing more on health and quality.
And there's Claude Chidia.
Oh, Sarah.
Well, Sarah.
Oh, sorry.
Just made it.
But I'm Sarah Abud. I am also at the College of Nursing at the University of Illinois in Chicago. I studied nursing both undergrad and master's in Lebanon, and I also worked for several years in the clinical setting and also in the community setting with NGOs. And I still conduct now research both in Lebanon and in the US with ABS around sexual health promotion.
We have three other board members. Angela Masour, so I mentioned her briefly. She's a faculty at the American University of Beirut. She teaches in the School of Nursing. And is actually working currently on integrating the curriculum into the School of Nursing around.
She's also a clinical nurse specialist and practices in Lebanon as well. We have Claude Chidia, who is in London. He is a palliative care specialist who teaches and practices, and he runs LGBT health education around the London area.
And we have Michel Danfal, who's our most recent recruit. He's a psychologist in Lebanon, and he is also part of the Lebanese Psychiatric Association, the Psychological Association. He focuses partially also on LGBT health and sexual health, and he's based in Beirut. They're all watching us now through Beirut Facebook, so that's our team. We have also our employees, one of our executive director, Bianca, who flew all over from Lebanon, and our Break the Silence winner, from Lebanon to attend this conference. They've learned a ton. And Kate was our actually intern. She was one of our practicum people from Johns Hopkins last year, working on the Transgender Health Project. Yeah, that's the team.
A lot more people that we
didn't get to mention, but we're doing a lot of work. That's a zero. All right.
I have like one more question if you have one.
Yeah, if anybody does.
We'll take one more.
Last call.
Otherwise, you can hear a lot more about us tonight at the gala dinner. We're so happy to be honored by a wonderful organization.
Yeah, we're receiving tonight the Achievement Award, and we'll talk a little bit about ourselves as well.